sure that is.
So is she seeing that?
Says we're live.
She's checking. Thank you all for attending this afternoon's talk by Dr. Wendy Hesford, which is entitled Exceptional Children, Human Rights Rhetoric and Recognition Scenes. So this event is featured as the Rhetoric Society of America's annual webinar lecture, and it's being broadcast to interested scholars across the country. My name is Derek Griesbach. I'm a second year PhD student here, and I'm also the co-president of Pitt's RSA student chapter, along with Dominique Johnson, who will be introducing Dr. Hesford momentarily. But first, we wanted to recognize and thank some of the people and institutions that made this possible. Our departmental czars, Mary Hamler, Julie Rosal, and Brandon McLean, are the backbone not only of this event, but of everything that goes on in our department. In the English department, Joe Klucharowski was hugely helpful in organizing the space and the technology. Importantly, I'd like to express a deep gratitude to Professor Olson and Professor Bielostowski, who are co-sponsors. Dr. Bielostowski, of course, is the chair of the English department, and Dr. Lester Olson is the chair of the communication department. Against our otherwise chaotic impulses, they have managed to ensure the smooth functioning of our organization, so thank you. Next, we'd like to recognize the organizations that made the event possible. First, we would like to thank the Rhetoric Society of America, which graciously awarded us with the seed grant to host this event. Today's event is further presented by the University of Pittsburgh's Kenneth P. Diedrich School of Arts and Sciences, and particularly the Department of Communication, the Department of English, the Gender, Sexuality, and Women's Studies program, the Graduate Program for Cultural Studies, and the Humanities Center. And last but certainly not least, we have been supported by Carnegie Mellon University's Three Rivers RSA student chapter. In fact, the collaborative efforts between graduate students at Pitt and Carnegie Mellon greatly highlight the efforts of the Rhetoric Society of America to foster creative cross-pollination between not only universities and departments, but also between rhetoricians and the rhetorical client. Finally, for those of you tuning in remotely, you're welcome to follow the conversation and ask questions on our Twitter at hashtag SpectacularRhetorics. With that, I'll turn it over to Dominique Johnson to introduce our guest.
Good evening. It's truly an honor to introduce our guest speaker for our student chapter's first public event. Dr. Wendy Hesford is professor of English at The Ohio State University, where she teaches courses in rhetoric and composition, human rights law and literature, and gender and sexuality studies. Her current research project, Exceptional Rhetorics, Regulating Childhood and Children's Rights, examines representations of the rights of children identified as living in between or outside of citizenship. She's the author of Framing Identities, Autobiography and the Politics of Pedagogy, and Spectacular Rhetorics, Human Rights Visions, Recognitions, and Feminisms. She's also the winner of the 2012 Rhetoric Society of America Book Award, which is for Spectacular Rhetorics. She's a co-editor with Wendy Kozel of two collections, Haunts and Violations, Feminist Criticism and the Crisis of the Real, and just advocacy, women's human rights, transnational feminisms, and the politics of representation. She's published and has forthcoming essays and reviews in a range of journals, including PMLA, Biography, College English, Journal of Human Rights, Humanity, Modern Drama, Rhetoric Society Quarterly, and Sexualities and TDR, Journal of Performance Studies. So very extensive publication record there. Presently, Dr. Hesford is a visiting scholar at Emory University's Law School's Feminist Legal Project and Vulnerability and Human Condition Initiative. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Wendy Hesford.
So thank you so much for having me, for that great welcome, and for all of the co-sponsors. I know how difficult and challenging it can be to pull something together, so I appreciate it. And this was so smooth, so thank you. Let me say a little bit about how I was thinking of proceeding, which is not all that radical, but slightly different from maybe a regular keynote address. Oh, can't go over there. So I will also be watching myself on this monitor, but if I don't see myself, I know I've wandered too far. I thought maybe about two-thirds of the way through, after I show a short video clip, that we can open up the conversation. So not so much Q&A, like asking me questions about what I've said thus far or the clip, but you give me your interpretations of what I'm showing you. So you do an analytical, little analytical move on a very, I think it's 3-minute clip, video clip. So if that's okay with everyone, and if you feel comfortable participating, I would welcome that. Just to give my voice a break, because I am getting over a cold, but also just it'll make it more interesting, I think. And then I can engage your critiques as part of the, from your observations as part of the Q&A. So unless anybody wants to say no to that, is that all right? So about two-thirds of the way through, just stop, show a very short clip, and I'll bring it up. Okay, so I have prepared a more or less keynote, which means it is, it's an extensive piece that does a little bit of where I've gone or come from and where I'm going. And I've tried to make it accessible, thinking about a broad audience. So that's one of the reasons why I have a handout with some of the bibliographical information, as well as some of the major or key, I should say, definitions. I mean, you don't need to look at it, but it's there for your reference. And I also have a PowerPoint, which will go along with the talk, which is a series of slides. So there's not a lot of text on the PowerPoint, so mostly just on the keynote. So the title, as you can see, Exceptional Children, Human Rights Rhetoric and Recognition Suits. In Spectacular Rhetorics, I consider how the human rights spectacle of suffering delimits the public response to violence and injustice. I use the term spectacular human rights rhetoric to signify sensational representations, the common definition, and to refer to discourses of vision, such as the seeing is believing paradigm, modes of visibility, and the distribution of visible capital in human rights politics. Attending to the structures of visibility and invisibility that define the moral discourse of human rights and humanitarianism, as it is inflected by and targeted for Western audiences, requires viewing persuasion or rhetoric more broadly as a practice of making and remaking social relations and incorporating subjects into discursive formations and regimes of truth. Implicit to my work, therefore, is a view of rhetoric as forms of symbolic communication through which identity, social relations, and relations of power are articulated and through which subjects are incorporated into systems of value. And anytime I'm doing a definitional move, it should be on your handout if you wanted to follow on that. So this is not persuasion in the classical sense of rhetoric, as Rachel Ryder and Kevin Mahoney put it, but persuasion as a mode of authoritative discourse enacted materially on bodies, practices, subjectivities, cultures, and communities. Human rights, I argue, in Spectacular Rhetorics, can be considered a discourse of public persuasion that envisions certain scenes of rhetorical address, self-other hierarchical scenes of recognition chief among them. So I'm using the term recognition scenes to point to the terms, conventions, the norms that establish a subject, whether it's an individual, a group, or population, for recognition. What makes someone recognizable within any given context or through any given framework. The history of human rights can be told as a history of selective and differential visibility. which has positioned certain bodies, populations, and nations as objects of recognition and granted others the power and means to look or confer recognition. In my work, I'm interested in the conditions of social recognition that constitute the human rights subject and how struggles for recognition are mediated by historical contingencies and the imagining imaging technologies through which such struggles are played out. Spectacular Rhetorics pays particular attention to how human rights discourses, structured by visual constructs of recognition and witnessing, become entangled with systems of identification, gender, race, class, ethnicity, nationality, ability, and sexuality, to produce the world citizen subject of human rights internationalism. So for me, then, the human rights spectacle refers not to individual images, but to social and rhetorical processes of incorporation and recognition mediated by visual representations and the ocular centricity that underwrites the discourse of human rights. In contrast to deterministic conceptions of the spectacle, then, which are common from the Situationist International group and Guy Debord, I approach the human rights spectacle as a rhetorical phenomenon through which differentially empowered social constituencies negotiate the authority of representation. The human rights spectacle is riddled with paradoxes and contradictions. These paradoxes become apparent when we track how the human rights spectacle travels across cultural and national boundaries and is appropriated, translated, and historicized. The cover of Amnesty International's USA Imagine campaign brochure provided an opportunity for me in the book to demonstrate its rhetorical intercontextual methodology. To read intercontextually, again, another definition on the handout, is to identify within a text or performance the internal reference to other texts or rhetorical acts, to become reflexive about the social codes and habits of interpretation, and to comprehend how texts produce context and are shaped by the context that produce them. So there's a kind of dialogic great relationship there. Amnesty International's USA Imagine campaign in 2002 to inspire a new wave of global human rights launched its campaign in 2002 to inspire a new wave of global human rights activism, which included a compact disc of international artists performing iconic John Lennon songs. Amnesty International created posters showing vulnerable populations, several of which, like the brochure cover here on the left, included close-ups of individuals with no context at all in them, so tightly framed scenes. The brochure cover image is of an unnamed Afghan girl who lives in a refugee camp in Peshawar, Pakistan. The phrase, human rights, human dignity, is superimposed on her face, and these words frame the girl's sea-green eyes. Diffused turquoise light radiates through the center of the image, drenching all but the horizontal band across her eyes. Her youth, beauty, and innocence are common signs of the gendering and racialization of sympathy in the international human rights imaginary. The girl's direct yet vulnerable stare echoes the haunting gaze of another Afghan girl, an iconic figure who was featured on the cover of the June 1985 issue of National Geographic. And this is a widely circulated image, which you're probably aware of. So this image, according to the photographer Steve McCurry, who often works for and still works for National Geographic, came to stand for, as he put it, the troubled face of Afghanistan. Although the United States, with its strict refugee laws, has granted asylum to few of the world's refugees, the Afghan girl has become a symbol of American charity and compassion, a representation that rests on the narrative configuration of the girl refugee as a deserving victim in need of rescue, and on the familiar dualism of tradition and modernity, which ignites hierarchical human rights and humanitarian recognition scenes. The blurring of all but the young girl's eyes also graphically makes a burqa out of the more revealing hijab that she wears. That is, her head covering is made more conservative than it actually is. The word imagine recasts the Western Orientalist fantasy of imagining what is behind the veil as a project of imagining the girl with rights and dignity. In other words, the incorporative process reiterates social hierarchies, wherein the spectator is configured as the holder of rights and as their distributor. The attribution of the status of the Afghan girl as a human rights subject is achieved through the superimposition of the language of human rights on perceptions of the headscarf or veil, which Westerners typically view as emblems of the oppression of women and girls under Islam, a perception, of course, that ignores Muslim women's use of the veil in acts of solidarity and resistance, among other things. Now, I interviewed Amnesty International's media director because I was curious to why they had chosen that earlier image, especially because it resonated so much with the earlier one. And wouldn't you know, that's why they chose it, he told me, because of its resonance. So the media director, Steve Rual, at Amnesty International, the USA chapter of it, indicates that the marketing team chose the girl with the green shawl for its Imagine campaign brochure cover because the photograph resonated with the more famous shot of the other Afghan girl. Her direct gaze at the camera, he explains, quote, is symbolic of the connections that Amnesty tries to encourage everyone to forge through a shared mission to protect one another's rights, end quote. His description suggests a relation of mutual recognition that aims to move beyond Orientalist representations. Amnesty International's motive, however, may be incongruous with historical associations that the image evokes in its targeted audience, which includes the legacies of Western imperialism parading under the cloak of international humanitarianism and the projection of the Afghan girl as a compelling object of identification. These two photographs of Afghan girl refugees, as framed by National Geographic and Amnesty International, therefore do not tell the girl's story as much as they tell a story about American exceptionalism. Diverse political forces, technologies, and cultural expectations have kept the figure of the Afghan girl in the public eye. Following the 2001 terrorist attacks on the U.S., in a climate of invigorated American nationalism, there was a renewed interest in the iconic figure of the Afghan girl. And just as an aside, I don't know if any of you were at Four Seas in March of 2003, but that is when I came across, just hanging out of my hotel room, the film by National Geographic in search of the Afghan girl. Right, so that was just soon after we had invaded or started to occupy Iraq, and the kind of chaotic moment there, the timeliness of that is really unsettling in a lot of ways. Why are we looking for her now? And for whom is she missing anyway? I mean, to call it the missing, the search for the Afghan girl. I mean, I don't think she's missing from her own family in her own region. So that was an interesting appropriation and return to her image. 17 years after the photographer Steve McCurry took the now infamous photograph of the Afghan girl, he returned to Pakistan and Afghanistan with the National Geographic film crew to find her. McCurry had learned that the refugee camp in Peshawar, Pakistan, where he photographed her in 1984 and also then photographed this latest refugee, was going to be replaced by a housing project. The film follows him on his search for the Afghan girl. He shows the photograph to village elders who share it with their contacts, and after several false leads, as well as several women who say, that's me, and they're not, and in some cases clearly not the woman, he finally finds her, identifies her as Sharbat Ula, and they find her through imaging technology, iris imaging technology that the FBI uses, and the National Center for Exploited and Missing Children. So then we get National Geographic, after they find her, we get this image on the cover of National Geographic, found. So she's holding the earlier image of herself. And in Just Advocacy, the introduction to the book that I co-edited with my proposal, we do a more extensive reading of this film. But basically, one of the key claims I want to just put out for today is not only the question about framing the entire narrative as if she were missing, or whom is she missing, but also for us to think about how the cover image and headline display the cultural politics of American exceptionalism, which construes Muslim women and girls as nothing more than victims of their culture, religion, and men. The National Geographic cover visualizes the ideology of American exceptionalism. Of course, the idea that America is uniquely different and superior. Now, although the terms exception, exceptional, and states of exception are commonly used to refer to an entity, nation, institution, or movement, or person that deviates from the norm, exceptions inevitably reify the normative. For example, the term exceptional child is alternatively used to refer to a child with above average intelligence or ability, or to a disabled child. In both cases, the exceptional child becomes part of the social order through a process of reinstating the normative. In political philosophy, the state of exception refers to efforts within the Western legal tradition, and this is a quote from Humphreys on your handout, to extricate sovereign power entirely from the law, or in a move to legislate for the law's own suspension. The Italian political philosopher Agamben argues that, quote, an order born of the exception emerges not by tracing a single line of inclusion and exclusion, but including something through its exclusion. Governments, of course, often turn to states of exception mechanisms as at moments of national crisis. Exceptionality haunts U.S. history, it haunts U.S. foreign policy. Perhaps, you know, one recent example would be the suspension of the Geneva Convention with regard to the U.S. treatment of detainees in the War on Terror. My current project, as Nikki already summarized somewhat, so thanks for that, I can skip a few lines, Exceptional Rhetorics, Regulating Childhood and Children's Rights, considers how the social, political, and legal mechanisms of exceptionality marshal the discourse of vulnerability to legitimate certain children's rights exclusions and attribute value or iconic status to certain children's lives and not others. I focus on the mechanisms of exceptionality at work in highly sensational cases of violence against children, namely individuals under 18, such as Malala Yousafzai, and she'll be the focus of the rest of the talk today, and Trayvon Martin. More broadly, the project also focuses on mass media, literary, cinematic, and activist representations of children's human rights at the turn of the 21st century, with particular attention to children living in states of political exception and social inclusion. So these would be the groups of children that are recognized under international law or that are becoming more and more focused in international activism. So those would be categories like the children of undocumented immigrants, child soldiers, child refugees, stateless children, and juveniles tried as adults in the criminal justice system. In addition to my focus on groups of children identified by international human rights law and its advocates as victims of state violence, I also plan to consider groups of children excluded from the class of vulnerable human rights subjects, such as street children and youth gangs. In the remainder of my talk, though, I want to turn to the media coverage of Malala Yousafzai and the recognition scenes that introduced her to us and to the elite international community. So this will now be the second part of the talk. On October 9th, 2012, 15-year-old Malala Yousafzai, an advocate for the educational rights of girls, was shot by a masked Taliban gunman in Pakistan's Swat Valley, a region from which the Pakistani army had claimed to have eliminated the Taliban. Excuse me. A bullet grazed Malala's skull and lodged in her neck. Two other girls, Kainat and Shazia, were also injured during the shooting. Shaziza, a 13-year-old eighth grader, remembers the masked man's scream, quote, "Which one is Malala?" She and the other girls fell silent. Malala was sitting next to her on her right, and Shaziza admits, "I think we must have looked at her. We didn't say anything, but we must have looked, because then he shot her. He shot her in the head." The gunman then shot Shaziza twice, just below her left collarbone and in her left hand, when she tried to protect herself. Then he shot Kainat, the 16-year-old 10th grader sitting next to her, in her left shoulder before backing out of the school truck. Soon after this assault, the chief spokesperson for the Pakistani Taliban, who preach a hardline form of Sunni Islam, claimed responsibility for the shooting and characterized Malala Yousafzai, who was also a Sunni Muslim, quote, as the symbol of infidels and obscenity, end quote. He had, quote, become a symbol of Western culture. If she survived, he vowed, Taliban militants would try to kill her again. So all three girls survived, as I said, though it was Malala's story that triggered an outpouring of support from the international community and widespread media attention. Unlike the unnamed Afghan girl of 1985, Malala Yousafzai is not simply a passive subject unto whom liberal recognition is conferred. Malala invests in and stakes claim to the international liberal imaginary in a variety of ways, most notably through the rationality of rights discourse and her own navigation of the international news media and social media outlets. Her entrance into international media came in 2009, that's 3 years before she was shot, when she wrote in an anonymous blog for the BBC Urdu about her life in the Swat Valley under Taliban rule. Later that year, she was featured in a documentary film by the New York Times correspondent Adam Elick. And in October 2001, a year before she was shot, she received Pakistan's first National Youth Peace Prize. Counter to the Taliban's attempt to silence her, the brutal assault turned her into a global icon, an agent for political moderation. As one reporter put it, Malala has become a potent symbol of resistance to militants' extremist ideology. The Prime Minister of Pakistan characterized Malala as, quote, the true face of Pakistan, and the Taliban's targeting of her as an indication of its fear of the power of her vision. Time magazine's decision to feature her, and here is the cover, on its December 2012 cover as the number two person of the year. Who do you think was person number one? Who? Obama. That's just a pause for a tea break. Times Magazine's decision to feature her as on the cover as the number two person of the year, runner-up to President Obama, exemplifies the American consumer's insatiable appetite for the exceptional individual. In Western liberal media, Malala is perceived as exceptional because she is different than fundamentalist Muslim women with whom she is compared. She is perceived as exceptional because she is more like us. Here we see how exception preserves mainstream American liberal and neoliberal cultural and political norms. Just as a footnote here, although I mobilize the concept of exception as a diagnostic tool in this project and the larger one, I am also critical of the politics of exceptionality, and I argue that the adverse politics of inclusion is not a definitive resolution, namely because inclusion often collapses differences into simple identifications and soft alliances. I'll talk about that later. The UN High Commissioner on Human Rights, Navi Pillay, released a statement on November 25, 2012, called the Malala Effect. So that's just a little over a month after the shooting, in which she admonished the international community to remember that Malala's case is not an exceptional. Had Malala been less prominent, she argued, her attempted murder might have passed more or less unnoticed. Despite all the advances in women's rights around the world, she continued, violence against girls and women remains one of the most common human rights abuses, and the assault on their fundamental right to education continues in many countries. I argue, following up on her argument, that the Malala effect is rooted in the logic of exceptionality. The Malala effect points to a rhetorical and ideological process whereby configurations of American exceptionality are bound by composite images of repressed Muslim women and normative storylines that turn a simple opposition, such as freedom and constraint, repression and resistance. The Malala effect also demonstrates the high stakes and political investment in controlling accounts of violence against children. Consider, for example, the contrast between elite Western media representations of Malala and the anonymous children killed by U.S.-backed NATO-led drone strikes in Pakistan. A comparative analysis of international media coverage of the Taliban's assassination attempt against Malala and the Afghan and Pakistani civilian casualties caused by the NATO-led drone strikes reveals the relative inattention in international stories that two international stories that implicate the U.S. as a violent actor. In the dissident voice, Edward Herman reports that 14 feature stories on Malala appeared in the New York Times between October 10th and 28th of 2012, and only one story about the three children who died as a result of an Afghan strike by NATO-led coalition appeared during that same period, and that piece was buried in the paper's midsection. A study from the Bureau of Investigative Journalism at the City University of London reports that U.S. drone strikes in Pakistan have killed between 411 and 884 civilians and 168 to 197 children. In contrast to the unnamed dehumanized children in Afghanistan and Pakistan killed by drones, Malala Yousafzai is not a nameless casualty of war. She is not stripped of biographical specificity or legal personhood. She is a righted subject that is a subject with right. She's received as such. Judith Butler argues that the... I'm going to need a tea break. Discuss among yourselves.
Okay. Let me know if you need anything.
Tea is good. See? Something better. Okay, so you always need tea before you read a quote by Judith Butler. Or something else. Judith Butler argues that the apprehension of another's precarity, quote, takes place at the limits of established norms of recognition. In this case, certain norms of recognition are disavowed as a means to deny the precarity of children killed by drones in Pakistan and Afghanistan. Among these norms is the disposition that regards the deaths of civilians in war, especially children, as unacceptable. What ethical principles can possibly justify such representational discrepancies? Who's granted the power to confer or withhold recognition of personhood and therefore of rights, and in what context? For my purposes today, I follow the lead of Navi Pillay, who turns our attention to the mechanisms of exceptionality that structure the terms of public engagement with Malala's story. Similar to my argument in Spectacular Rhetorics, here, too, I call into question the normative frameworks that establish the intelligibility of subjects with rights. In giving an account of oneself, Butler argues that recognizability precedes social political recognition. And that's exactly really the perspective that I'm taking here in looking for and looking at what terms, conventions, and norms establish Malala Yousafzai as a subject for recognition. In becoming a symbol for Pakistani moderates, Malala has also become a symbol for the West, a symbol for democratic maturation and the rationality of rights. But it was not only the gendered violence of the Taliban that spurred Western media interest. The assassination attempt also fueled narratives and recognition scenes about the attack as an assault on childhood innocence and the logic of futurism. In No Future, Lee Eidelman suggests, quote, the child has come to embody for us the telos of the social order and come to be seen as the one for whom that order is held in perpetual trust, end quote. Pakistani writer Salim Ali invoked in his National Geographic blog, in which he allied Charbagh Bhulla and Malala Yousafzai as Pashtun icons of hope. He invoked this logic, is what I meant to say. Women and girls like Bhulla and Yousafzai, he argues, quote, are testament to the feminine spirit that we often find as the most promising beacon at any frontier of human despair, end quote. Yet Ali also draws attention to class distinctions between the girls' lives and circumstances. He writes, we will need to remember not only the Malalas of the urban educated class of Pashtuns, but also the Charbagh Bhullas of remote and uneducated parts of the hinterland. Although Ali's goal may have been to widen the circle of recognition beyond exceptional figures such as Malala, linking Malala to the intensely commercialized National Geographic image of the Afghan girl sets up both girls as products of the elite Western international imaginary. A reporter for the International Business Times, P.R. Ghosh, for example, argues that Malala should be perceived as an exceptional role model for girls in the West. Not only is Malala depicted as different from Western girls, but she is characterized as mature beyond her years. Gosch quotes the Irish novelist Sinead Moriarty, who compares Malala's, quote, unselfish lifestyle with the behavior of spoiled, lazy, uncaring youths in the West, end quote. Moriarty writes, and here's another longer quote, perhaps we need to take down the posters of Cheryl Cole and Rihanna from our teenagers' bedrooms and replace them with posters of Malala. Where are the girls who want to change the world, not the size of their breasts? Where are the teenagers who want to grow up and rule the world, not the tabloids? Malala's life experiences may unsettle common representations of children in international news as unworldly and innocent of politics and history. But it was not long before the elite international media lessened Malala's political agency by transforming her into a diminutive humanitarian subject. This portrayal further vilified the Taliban and placed Malala as a child at the pinnacle of the hierarchy of innocence. After emergency treatment in a Pakistani hospital, 6 days after the shooting, she was relocated to Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Birmingham, England, which is known for its critical care unit. A video report on Malala's condition on the Huffington Post website, for example, is accompanied by photographs of a poised Malala wrapped in a pink and red floral headscarf bare at her side. And there are lots of images of this that circulated at the time of her reading Get Well cards from others and other children around the world. The omnipresence of Malala's father as well, who accompanies her to most social events, and has a profound influence on her life and her advocacy work, also, in some regards, reinforces an image of her as a child, as his daughter. These portrayals of Malala, one might argue, are mired in the rhetoric of colonial paternalism, wherein the first world is cast as the savior or caretaker of the third world, and where Islam is objectified as the obverse of Euro-American societies that self-identify, that is, as the West. Fraternal rescue narratives are also apparent in the repackaging of Malala's story as a neoliberal feminist narrative about third world girl empowerment. Over the last two decades, global development discourse has incorporated liberal feminist concepts of agency and empowerment in configuring girls of the global south as deserving of investment. The international initiatives launched in Malala's name in order to broaden public awareness of the plight of girls in the global south, and primary focus on girls' right to education, are framed in large part by the discourses of liberal feminisms and neoliberal economic development. The targeting of the girl child as a distinct demographic for development began in the early 1990s and was more formally articulated as a goal in the 1995 Beijing platform for action, which of course emerged from the UN's Fourth World Conference on Women. Across public and private sectors, investment in the impoverished adolescent girl of the global south is cast as one of high returns. Girl empowerment campaigns are increasingly part of corporate social responsibility portfolios of multinational corporations headed in the global north, such as Nike Foundation's The Girl Effect. Development discourse has shifted its rhetoric from representations of women and girls, particularly third world women and girls, or women and girls of the global south, from passive victims to self-regulating agents, though women and girls' agency is construed in large part in ways that fit a neoliberal social and economic arrangement. In October of 2013, that's 1 year after the shooting, Malala appeared in a feature story for The Girl Effect as a spokesperson for the Girl Declaration, which places girls at the center of the next generation of global development. A few more words about The Girl Effect, and then I would like to show the three-minute video and just see, you know, what do you notice about this video? And let's maybe generate an analysis together. The Girl Effect campaign approaches global poverty as a manageable, pragmatic problem that can be dealt with by educating girls, one at a time. The Girl Effect claims that, quote, investing in a girl before she is married, out of school, pregnant, and HIV positive is the ultimate solution to end poverty. But girls can't do it alone. They need the world to recognize them, listen to them, and invest in their potential. Girls are a smart investment to accelerate change. This isn't a social issue, it's smart economics, end quote. So let's look at the short video from the Girl Effect, which is part of the Nike Corporation and several other co-sponsors, about their introduction, basically, to their project. So now I think I need to escape and go to...
Yep, and I think you need it. Sorry.
Just the right one. Videos on this website. They do interviews as well, so there's biographical videos, which obviously we're not going to look at now. But so, what do you think? What do you notice about this particular video, given maybe some of the frameworks that I've presented so far, even just your own frameworks or observations? I've only recently come across this and integrated it into my teaching this semester, so I'm not an expert on it. So, I welcome your observations. What are like the dominant frameworks?
Well, it opens with we, the hour, and it's implied that the we is supposed to be everybody, but it's really only everybody who has this moment of sympathy and the language and the sort of structures that will allow these decisions to happen normally or conventionally. It's an interesting we.
Yeah.
Just a couple little, well, a couple partial things. If she's in poverty, she's out of control, meaning that if she is not poor, she's in control.
Mm-hmm.
She can go to school where she is safe. There are lots of schools that are really not safe at all by any means. And she can marry her children when she's ready without sort of further suggestion for that preparedness.
But it's clearly a self-regulation at that moment,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so there's some kind of turn to that, regulate yourself or enable her to regulate. Yeah, but what are some of the other like larger frameworks going on here?
Really, the assumption is that education will make her more like us.
Okay, so education is kind of assimilation or normative role of education, yeah.
There's a stunning generalization situation.
Yes.
That's the first move,
yeah.
After us. We have a situation where it brings so many things under one exigency.
Yeah, and what I'm thinking, so what is the main situation? Is it poverty? Because this is framed with the thinking. I mean, what does this suggest is the situation? What's out of control? Is it the corporations that are out of control, or the inequity, the economic inequities that are out of control? The more I see this, I've seen it, you know, maybe 10 times now, I've shown it in a couple of talks in class, it's like, it's the female adolescent that's out of control, right? That is framed almost as the situation. As, of course, as the solution, but also as the problem. You're shaking your head. I don't know if you're
thinking. It's just that she's only depicted in terms of her breasts. I don't know, well, when that picture has breasts, she covers them up. And then,
when is that moment? I mean, that's a sincere question, not a test.
She's growing to 7 to whatever, to 12, and suddenly there's some, like, breasts, and she goes like this.
Yeah.
To cover. And then after that, she's running for pants.
Yeah.
It's not just her, it's not her libido only, it's those hands.
Yeah, it's the threat of violence.
Well, but she doesn't have a, she covers
the threat. Yeah, yeah.
She can't have a sexuality.
Well, you're saying it's not just female adolescent, but that's out of control, it's the place that she finds herself in. But that's dangerous.
Yes, definitely dangerous and threatening, and that's what those hands, I think, are signifying there. Yeah.
It's like she is herself.
Yes,
like her body has like suddenly
yeah.
become dangerous.
Yes, that's what that's the mindful lesson. Any other observations?
One thing that I find interesting about this formatting of it is that sort of managed and dramatized the text the way that we're up called is impossible. So there's a pictorial on the text that is strange. And it's about time, so there's an incredibly sort of some ways rich and some ways frightening. Thematization of time, right? Body clock and ticking time bomb.
Yeah.
Appears at one where it's going to be, has to be covered because it's contracting attention, it has to be deflated. But it's also ticking clock that is whether we will act in response or not. And it's also sort of the constriction of the gaze at any given moment on the timeline where she is, versus the moments when we sort of pan back a little bit in order to sort of witness or experience an icon of the system in which she's living,
yeah.
To sort of get that overall shot.
Yeah.
And so it's, I mean, in some ways, despite the rugged nature of the clip, it's quite sophisticated in the way that it sort of dramatizes close out of this.
It is, and one of the observations some of my students made in my law and literature class this semester, which I thought was also interesting, is several of them thought that they could identify with the animated figure, the generalized universal figure, and they were saying that this was a rhetorical strategy that was persuasive, right? That they could identify because it was not marked, it was not contextualized, right? So I thought that was interesting. Usually, typically, well, one of the things we always want, right, is as scholars, is contextualization. Tell us what the situation is, how, you know, how did this come to be, etc. But in this case, it's stripping that all down, right, to some animated generic figure And so I wonder if any of you, maybe in contrast to my students' observations, or maybe share it, see the child as marked in any way. You know, is it socially marked or identified, or is it, I mean, would you agree that it's a generic figure?
The figure doesn't really seem to be marked, but I was, in context a little bit of that, one of the last things that appeared was it said 50 million or whatever number of these girls in these 50 million situations, which kind of encourages us to think that extrapolate from the generic figure to think that it's particular, which maybe sort of forces us to resist looking for a generic or systemic solution, or towards something like a microfinance. We can solve this problem one by one with your personal donation or something like that.
That's really what, I mean, this foundation is all about. It is a version of microfinancing. It's picking up on that.
What is the foundation?
It's called the Girl Effect, but it's basically launched by Nike Foundation, the Nike Corporation. And there are some additional co-sponsors who help out with it.
How is it distributed?
How is the money they get distributed?
No, the video.
Online. On YouTube or their website, basically. Okay, so let me share some of my preliminary observations about this, and I think that you had some really good ones that I'm going to want to cite at some point. But I was thinking that, one, and this goes back to what the woman in the green sweater was saying. I mean, I'm thinking of this clock is ticking video as construing global poverty as a problem that can be solved by the social but also self-regulation of the sexuality of adolescent girls in the global south. And that this nondescript animated figure of the girl child is marked only, or seems to be marked only, by the onset of sexual maturity. The video proposes that by 12 years old, she will face a future out of her control. By 14, she will be married off, and by 15, pregnant. The dissonance between the pregnant body and the pigtails was also interesting to me there. And the beckoning, and this is your point, I think, the long extended arms, right, suggests that there is the threat of male violence, omnipresent or lingering. The campaign promise, and this goes to the microfinance part of it, I think, is that if she attends school and reproduces when she is ready, presumably later in life, that she will lift her family, community, and nation out of poverty. Here, as in other campaigns that focus on girl empowerment, education is explicitly linked to economic development and social change. The concept education as development has emerged as a core strategy for eliminating poverty and as barometer of the progress of our progress, the U.S. progress in the war on terror. NGOs, UN organizations, and national government, UN chapters, and national governments encourage school attendance even in conflict-affected fragile states. One of the reasons that education as development focus has gained so much traction in the international arena is precisely because it has the appearance of a neutral, presumably, or maybe purely humanitarian rallying point for international donors. It's not complicated, right? It doesn't seem to be as complicated. Of course it is, but it's framed as a right that is a comfortable right. Right, to support. It's not controversial to support it, which is probably why you get all the multinationals coming in on the project, and because the focus is in large part on education as economic development. In other words, formal education, school attendance rates, and the rebuilding of schools in conflict states are cataloged as benchmarks for security and progress in counterterrorism campaigns. The Girl Effect campaign situates private-public economic collaborations as a solution to global poverty, but it does not address how the privatization of aid and globalization of capital contribute to the problem. And I mean, I don't think we would expect it to do that on a campaign by the Nike Foundation anyway. Constituted as the poorest of the poor, as Michelle Murphy puts it, the girl child of the global south functions as an alibi for a host of devaluations produced in capitalist and violent terrains that render life disposable, end quote. Moreover, the Girl Effect promotes education as development, but does not address the education as development paradox, which someone brought up, I think, in the back, which is basically the consequences of the militarization of education, that is, education in the context of insecurity facilitates greater gender inequity. So encouraging girls to go back to schools that are rebuilt in conflict-affected areas is actually putting them at greater risk a lot of the time. Female school children and teachers become the victims of terror attacks at a disproportionately high rate. Sonia Grover put it well in her study, School Children as Propaganda in the War on Terror. The right to life, she says, construed as an inclusive, as inclusive of the right to be protected from all forms and degrees of physical and psychological violence, has been subordinated to the right to education. Human Rights Watch report, I wanted to check on this to see what the percentage of school violence or violence against girls' schools in Pakistan of late has been. And in the 2013 Human Rights World report, they indicate that Islamic militants regularly attack students and teachers in a range of countries, primarily, though, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Iraq, and that attacks against educational institutions are 108% higher in Pakistan than any other country, with 120 bombings in schools in 2012 alone. That was a shock. So one of the questions I've been asking myself, thinking about this education as development discourse, is the degree to which Malala herself is using it. I mean, her advocacy is for education, for girls' education. So I'm interested to see, you know, the ways in which she's linking it to economic development, or the ways in which her story is being appropriated to serve that particular framework. So some of the questions that I continue and will continue to explore will be questions like, to what degree or in what ways has Malala's advocacy for girls' education been used as propaganda in the U.S. war on terror and counter-terrorist campaigns? And to what degree does Malala link the right to education to the right to security? So the third part of the talk, if I can get it maybe back to the PowerPoint, to escape, is called Recognition and Responsivity. And this begins with a discussion and some long quotations, which are on your handout, I believe, of Malala's UN speech. Thank you. So standing before nearly 1,000 youth activists and dignitaries at the UN on July 12, 2013, draped in the shawl of the late Benazir Bhutto, Pakistan's first woman prime minister, Malala diffuses the hero narrative that had been projected onto her. In response to the UN declaration of July 12, which is her birthday, as Malala Day, she declares, quote, Malala Day is not my day. Today is the day of every woman, everybody, and every girl who have raised their voice for their rights. There are hundreds of human rights activists and social workers who are not only speaking for their rights, but who are struggling to achieve their goal of peace, education, and equality. Thousands of people have been killed by the terrorists, and millions have been injured. I am just one of them. So here I stand, one girl among many. I speak not for myself, but so those without a voice can be heard, end quote. Malala makes the same self-sacrificing move, the suffering without retaliation, that we have come to associate with historical figures who espouse the philosophy of nonviolence, and that she also mentions in her speech, including the founding father of Pakistan and a Shiite, which furthers her call for the application of universal human rights principles in overcoming Sunni and Shia schisms. Although Malala invokes liberal internationalism's emphasis on individual rights, she does not prioritize liberalism's focus on bodily violation and its conjoining of the heroic with the abject. In this way, she works against the human rights spectacle of suffering. Instead, she turns to the philosophy and rhetoric of nonviolence to articulate social bonds through a sense of shared vulnerability and responsibility. Malala links nonviolence to universal human rights, namely to the right to education, and yet her engagement with these utopian discourses moves toward a more critical humanism, attuned to the exception and human interdependence as foundations for global engagement. Malala rewrites the norms of social and political recognition, by extending a nonviolent response to her adversaries, the Taliban terrorist who shot her, and to the children of the Taliban. She says, this is also part of the UN speech, I am not against anyone. Neither am I here to speak in terms of personal revenge against the Taliban or any other terrorist group. I am here to speak for the right of education for every child and daughters of the Taliban and all of the terrorists and extremists. I do not even hate the Taliban who shot me. Even if there was a man in my gun in my hand and he was standing in front of me, I would not shoot him. Here Malala denies the Pakistani Taliban the display of animosity necessary for its ongoing violent campaign, and more broadly, she condemns the violence of war. She says, quote, peace is necessary for education. Let us pick up our books and our pens. They are the most powerful weapons. By the way, often what you get when that quote is excerpted, you don't get the first part of it. If you see some interviews with her that have been cut or parts of the speech, you don't get peace is necessary for education. You get, let us pick up our books and our pens, those powerful weapons. Malala's focus on peace as a precondition for the realization of education rights points toward a more expansive philosophy of rights than that espoused by Western powers in the post-9/11 context, wherein military and humanitarian interventions in the Muslim world have been premised on strict us and them identifications. Just as Malala rejects the exceptional narrative for herself, she incorporates the children of the Taliban as part of universal humanity and thereby denies their exceptionality as well. In aligning herself with the children of the Taliban, Malala places the rights of all children before the political concerns of those involved in the conflict. And in linking the right to education to the right to security, she throws political actors on all sides of the conflict into an irreconcilable conflict. How can the parties to the conflict maintain their political military positions and keep all children safe? Moreover, in rejecting the subjectivity of victim that has been projected onto her, and as she has said, I do not think of myself as the girl who has been shot, Malala rejects the media impulse to reduce her into a spectacle of gendered victimization. So if Malala can reject the transnational projection of the identity of the suffering foreign child in need of rescue, then why can't we or our media? If Malala can reject normative identifications, such as the notion that children are not political actors, then why can't we reject that? The I Am Malala petition, launched by Gordon Brown, former Prime Minister of England and current UN envoy for global education, exemplifies the risks and compensation of normative identifications. Signatories to the I Am Malala petition pledged to take up the UN Millennium Development Goal, which is to get 61 million primary school-aged children presently shut out of school into school by the end of 2012. Each signature to the I Am Malala petition may rhetorically take on the identity of Malala. However, identifications that purportedly give voice to the other, especially when uttered by those that occupy spaces of structural privilege and relative safety, can function as acts of self-creation or self-recognition scenes. We are certainly not all Malala. The rhetoric of identification and substitution that underwrites the I Am Malala campaign foregoes a deliberating I and you. In Deliberative Acts, rhetorical theorist Arabella Lyon observes, quote, in its seemingly abstract impartiality, identification hides the powerful differences of material conditions, which lend force to identification as a vehicle for creating outcomes and consensus. And she goes on in a different part of her book to say, like other movements, earlier movements, the I Am Netta campaign being one of them, Netta Sultan was murdered during an election protest in Iran in 2009, and there was the I Am Netta campaign, and there are a lot of these I Am campaigns. Lyon argues, quote, that such campaigns exhibit a pathological willingness to claim a rape, murder, or bullet to the head as long as it is imaginable. The move to, and she continues to say, the move to glib identification potentially collapses the identity of the sufferer of rights violations and the observer, erasing agency and difference. Although identification poses as recognition, Lyon argues, it obliterates the other, end quote. Perhaps not surprisingly, given the ease of identification with the seemingly neutral endorsement of education rights, as well as the easy click of an electronic signature, my own included, Malala's education campaign has gained widespread support, including the support of the UN, UNESCO, the US feminist NGO Vital Voices, which established the Malala Fund, and the commitment of high-profile celebrities such as Angelina Jolie and Madonna. The I Am Malala petition met its goal of delivering 1 million signatures to the Pakistani president and the UN Secretary General just a month after the shooting. And a month after that, after receiving the petition, the Pakistani president announced the establishment of a $10 million educational fund in Malala's name. So clearly, I mean, in this case, identification has generated, you know, some new priorities, or perhaps more cynically, some might say it's a response to feeling shamed that this has happened in one's own country. I think you can read that a number of ways. But in contrast to the rhetoric of the I Am Malala petition, photographs of Pakistani girls holding closely cropped photographs of Malala on placards and t-shirts at tributes and protests divert attention from identification and substitution to the process of recognition itself. Among the most instructive of the photographs that circulated in international news media for my purposes here is of young girls at a protest in Lahore just days after the Taliban's brutal assault against Malala. The girls in this clip, in this photo, are affiliated with a school developed by the Pakistani Swedish Teachers Association in Pakistan, whose purpose is to, as they put it, to fight poverty and enforce the basic rights that are in accordance with the UN Charter. In addition to images of Malala pasted onto Get Well placards, there are also several posters that host the phrase, I am also Malala. While the addition of the adverb also may seem insignificant, it is an important recognition of difference. It is not a substitution of need for you. I am also Malala implies a shared rhetorical vision, but not a collapsed identification. The declaration, I am also Malala, moves away from depictions of Malala as an exceptional singular figure toward an acknowledgement of the widespread violence against women and girls. Photographs of Pakistani girls holding I Am Malala signs do not present viewers with the authority of conferring or withholding recognition. That role has been taken from us, and importantly so. Some might argue that the images of Pakistani girls holding up signs written in English were orchestrated only for Western eyes. But such a view overlooks the fact that although the national language of Pakistan is Urdu, like Malala, many Pakistani children learn to speak and write in English at school. Thus, to describe these children's rhetorical acts as a capitulation to Western audiences, I think, is to fail to register the risk that these particular children face in politically aligning themselves with Malala, and more broadly, their efforts to claim a deliberative space among local and global publics. As American audiences, we are not that accustomed to bearing witness to acts of solidarity among girls in the global south. We're either targeted for charitable donations that aid girls of the global south, or we're cast as witnesses to the alleged liberation of women and girls in areas in which the U.S. has militarily intervened, or we become mere consumers of the exceptional individual girl. How might we read, for example, the gatherings of support for Malala at the Global Women's Institute at George Washington University, the faculty and students holding poster-sized versions of the cover of Malala's memoir, which is titled I Am Malala. While the title might be read as Malala's belated yet defiant response to the Taliban who asked that deadly question that day on the bus, remember, who said, who was Malala? Does the fact that her defiance and story has catapulted to the New York Times bestseller list suggest that deliberative opportunities and the right to security of person and education have contracted into undemanding forms of cultural consumption and display? Is this image yet another mass-marketed composite of the Save the Muslim Girl, or perhaps the more recent Invest in the Girl of the Global South narrative? Are we simply too caught up in the narcissism of exceptionality to create deliberative publics? Correspondingly, freelance journalist Asad Beg contemplates the motives behind Western media's spotlight on Malala. In his Huffington Post blog, he argues that Malala has been cast as the, quote, good native, and that her story, as told by Western media, partakes in the white savior complex, which demonizes the non-white Muslim man. While I subscribe to certain elements of his reading, to typecast Malala as the good native effaces the sheer complexity of her negotiation of norms, customs, and discourse as a historical living being, as well as the influential role of her father, who has received a lot of media attention prior as well as after for his support of girls' rights after her shooting. During her meeting with President Obama, prior to her appearance at the World Headquarters, Bank Headquarters, and here you can see, we get the image of her book on everything now where she appears. So during her meeting with President Obama, just prior to this meeting, she expressed her concerns that drone attacks are fueling terrorism. She told the president, quote, that innocent victims are killed in these acts, and that such acts lead to resentment among Pakistani people. She urged the president to, quote, refocus efforts on education. Although her meeting with President Obama and the publication of her memoir, in which she also critiques U.S. and NATO-led drone strikes, although these posts date some of the early accusations of Malala as the good native, such sweeping accusations persevere in critical academic discourse and discussions of her, and I think problematically so, namely because it's setting up this kind of binary logic which judges Muslim women's rights to be either collusion with imperialism or, on the other hand, something to be celebrated, right, as a hopeful sign of universal emancipation. Like, there's no other possibilities here. To claim that that Malala simply reproduces secular liberal norms is to ignore how she deploys rights arguments as tools to address the needs of women within Islamic communities. In contrast to post 9/11 life narratives from the Islamic Middle East, in which Muslim women writers renounce their faith, in her memoir and public speeches, Malala embraces her Islamic faith and Pashtun culture, though she's critical of them as well, as she says in her memoir, quote, particularly where the treatment of women is concerned. Malala's rhetoric echoes that of women reformers in Muslim communities who refuse to choose between religion and rights and turn our attention to the stymied debates over rights within religion and the default enlightenment notions of religious sovereignty within human rights law, that is, that it's untouchable. In linking the philosophy of nonviolence and women and girls' rights to the Islamic tradition, Malala steers us toward an understanding of human rights as a transnational process of mediating how norms are lived. And here's my mini conclusion. I have argued that the Malala effect, the mass circulation and appropriation of Malala Yousafzai's story, is rooted in the logic of exceptionality that underwrites liberal internationalism and its differential distribution of vulnerability and valued lives. In contrast to the turn to vulnerability in feminist legal studies, which departs from identity-driven rights, I argue for an exceptional rhetorical analytic that brings to the foreground how vulnerability resides in structures of subjection that incite identity-based norms of recognition. I have aimed to demonstrate how elite international media have tamed Malala Yousafzai's rhetoric by translating her resistance into storylines that turn on simple oppositions, and how international governmental and non-governmental organizations have catapulted her story into stock neoliberal narratives of girl empowerment. A few months ago, at the 2013 Watson Symposium, which is a rhetoric and composition symposium held at the University of Louisville, in response to a shorter version of this talk, a colleague asked me, how can we rhetorically stand with Malala? If we understand the force of Malala's agency in the production of the Malala effect as a complex relationship to norms, then I would argue we stand with Malala when we critically engage those in positions of power to authorize the form that norms take, and when we advocate for material conditions conducive to deliberative resolutions to conflicts. The Malala effect compels us as rhetorical and cultural critics to acknowledge the intelligibility of Malala as an agent navigating the complex discursive and political machinery of rights, cultural norms, and the protocols of global engagement. Thank you very much.
That was fantastic. Thank you, Dr. Hesford. So we have plenty of time for Q&A, and I think we'll start things off with a question that we got from Twitter or Facebook from Stephanie Larson. She asks, what might recognition look like beyond the trappings of inclusion or exceptionality?
That's a great question. What might recognition look like? Well, I mean, in part, what I think it needs to look like is we're moving toward the end of the paper, right? Where's Stephanie? Can Stephanie see me, or can Stephanie go and hear me?
She's in that. She can hear you.
She can't see me, though. Anyway, Stephanie, I'm thinking that, you know, what we need to do is think about the frameworks of recognition, right? So if we're thinking of the dominant frameworks that we, meaning mainstream media in the United States, would bring to a story like Malala, we talked about this a little bit in the graduate workshop today, right? We're bringing a number of frames, but some of the most prominent would be certain notions of childhood and how we should perceive a child. You know, whether a child is a political actor or a moral actor, or at what age they become a moral or a critical actor. So for me, I mean, part of thinking about recognition in another way is first and foremost, within this context of Malala, is rethinking our notions of childhood and child dependency, and rethinking the idea that dependency automatically, annihilates agency or annihilates agency. I guess I would say in that case, right? So in other words, a child may be dependent, right, on adults in various ways and in various times in their lives. But it doesn't mean just because you are dependent that you're not also a political actor. So I think first and foremost, it's just rethinking what do we mean by child and what are our notions of childhood? Primarily because Malala is really an icon, not so much really of political moderation, although she's been used that way, but of youth activism. And there's a lot of it going on that we're just not hearing or giving attention to, you know, the youth activism, including the dreamers among them. So I think it's recognizing children as political subjects.
And any questions for those folks here in the room?
How much of all of actual action we can hear them when he's been made a subject of the lawyers that gave Trump. Like, I didn't know she was against Trump insurance. Like, that never entered me if anyone died.
Say the beginning of your question again.
How much control as an activist, as a youth activist, can she have?
She has. Yeah. Well, I don't think any of us have any. And you're going to have complete control as soon as it's appropriated or, you know, circulated, right? We're losing control, we're losing frameworks. But she's also, you know, appropriating herself certain frameworks that she or her father or whoever her advisors are, right, know are going to work in certain contexts. And she'll tread lightly on some of her critiques of, you know, like the U.S. drones, et cetera, in certain contexts. You know, she's more explicit in her memoir about it than she is in the U.N. speech, although it comes out in the U.N. speech, too. So I guess I don't think that, you know, for me it's not so much an element of control, you know, like what control does she have or doesn't have. I'm more interested in how it's appropriated, how she will be historicized as we move through and away from her case. I guess it goes back to my understanding of agency, right? Which again, we talked about in the graduate workshop. For me, agency, rhetorical agency, is always operates at an intercontextual level. So you're always appropriating or in dialogue with other frameworks or codes or provisions or conventions. So it's a matter of, you know, sometimes consciously, sometimes not, you know, adapting them to your needs. So, you know, how much control does she have of that? I don't know. I don't have insight into that process.
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you have an insight in, just into the production of the book, for instance, or the production of the talk before the UN?
The book was actually done in collaboration, as many of these texts are, with an editor. And it's very much, and what you can tell from the memoir, if you read, and I've read quite a bit, not a lot, but dozens at least, of memoirs that are more or less humanitarian oriented, human rights memoirs written by children, or former, or about their, like, child soldiers, former child soldiers. And what you see is a common trajectory, and it's true to a degree in hers as well. And that common plot, which is often a transformation narrative of sorts, and it is often a transformation into the mechanisms or beliefs of an international law. Like in the case of child soldiers, just to give that quick example. In the Ishmael Bey book, A Long Way Gone, and some of these other child soldier narratives, you get the complication of the figure of the child, right? Because you have the child who's also a perpetrator of violence, so it's no longer the innocent child. So it's working out that complication. And part of the working out in the text has to do with the way in which it is worked out internationally through the law, which is that these children need to be reintegrated and re-socialized. It's heavily invested in psychological and social services. Right? So the book follows that trajectory because that's the experience of the person going through that system. Right? So in some ways, hers is following a system of intervention. Right? It starts off with her giving a lot of background on her own culture, so it's almost ethnographic in that sense. Right, educating those who don't know, really for Western audience, clearly. Right, so you know that's part of the editorial advice. But then there are also parts which seem to kind of veer out of that, you know, which is the critique of the U.S. But some of it's more moderated too, where she's like, well, you know, she doesn't want to say anything too bad about the U.S. and she'll kind of say that. I don't want to come across as, you know, criticizing, but she will. So there's also this moderation that's going on, which suggests to me that, you know, it's heavily devised in terms of its appeal for a British, she's got a lot of coverage in Britain, and U.S. audience. So other than knowing, you know, the narrative templates that are being employed and that are surfacing, I don't know. And I don't have any other insight about the actual editing process.
I'm really interested about the rewriting of norms of recognition. You mentioned that she did so particularly by the way that she diffuses and says, you know, I'm speaking not only for myself, but for every girl, every person, every woman. Yet it seems like this sort of composite self-portrait sort of meshes pretty well within the norms of recognizability that doesn't seem to deviate, except that, of course, as you're saying, that it makes her seem like a more active agent. So
right, now that move in particular, I think, is very normative. That
exactly.
Move, that move itself.
Okay.
But I think she's making other moves, which I would say are breaking out of what, you know, the norms of recognizability, the kind of dominant norms of recognizability. And that would be bringing the issue of peace, nonviolence, and highlighting that as a precursor to, let's say, thinking about the right to education. I mean, what I see her doing is she has a more integrated understanding of rights, of human rights, than we often understand or embrace here in the West. And I mean our governments, not, you know, us as individuals necessarily, which would be, you know, separating out certain civil and political rights from social, economic, and cultural rights. And she has a much more fluid, I think, understanding of that. And that to me is, I mean, it's recognizable in some contexts, right? It's recognizable as in an international human rights context, but it's not that recognizable to the U.S. because we separate those out very clearly. You know, so much of the coverage of Malala is about her resilience, her speaking out, not so much her critiques. You know, it's about like her, yeah, her voicefulness. But you're right, that scene where she says she speaks for others, that's a classic scene, a classic moment of recognition. And not all that different, really, from the I Am Malala movie.
So we have a question from a remote guest, Abby Dubisar, who asks.
I know Abby. She's an OSU grad.
She asks, now that Malala is positioned as an author/author figure, what difference will this make, especially in relation to literacy studies?
You know, I'm thinking more and more about how exactly that question. You know, and for me, it's about thinking about the education as economic development narrative, right? And the way in which her story is going to play into that narrative. It's like talking to no one when you get the question. Does anyone else care about this question? I know you do, Abby, and I will continue to speak on it. But, I mean, it seems to me that becomes solidified, right? That, I mean, she herself, Malala, that is, does not in the material that I've seen written by her or interviews, does not make that link. It's not about invest economically in the girl of the global south. It's about peace. It's about stop the violence, primarily, and the consequences of that violence being school violence. So for me, I think what's happening with the publication of her memoir is that the commodification process is raising that narrative, the education as economic development narrative, as the next primary framework for understanding her case. And that is a kind of literacy narrative, and it's part of the literacy myth that, you know, Harvey Graf wrote about, I don't know how many decades ago now, 4 decades or whatever ago, right? The idea that education leads to economic improvement. And lots of other literacy scholars have said that, no, that's a myth. That's not the only factor.
I talked earlier about how there's...
Is this you or from someone else?
For me. I talked a little bit earlier about how this is a particular way that children are being used to push human rights efforts. And I wonder, what can you say or what do you think this might mean for Malala when she turns 18 and she's still pushing very radical... And for me, I'm thinking it seems like maybe we'll just get another brown girl to be the forefront of the movement. But what do you think?
I don't know if we'll get another brown girl. I mean, because Malala is so perfect. If you think about, you know, supporting the U.S. agenda, right, and the war on terror in a way, so this is why we are dropping drones because of this. You know what I mean? It is so legitimizing of a narrative for our nation, I think. And I don't know if there's room right now for another narrative. In terms of her, I mean, she has very ambitious aspirations. She wants to be prime minister of Pakistan. I mean, I don't think she's going anywhere. We'll just have to see how her story changes and the reception to her. She ages and gets more involved.
Other questions here? Brian, go ahead.
Is there any intent to educate the perpetrators and not the victims of violence? By Malala, or
no, say that again. I'm sorry, I was saying the box. Say that beginning again.
Is there an intent to educate the perpetrators and not the victims of the violence?
Well, that I think you could probably read into. I mean, it's not more than what you see in some of the quotes that I've given, but I think that's definitely a direction that. I mean, you could take her speech, right, about providing education for the children of the Taliban and the extremists. She doesn't take it that far, but yeah.
Go ahead.
I'm curious about, we talked about, or we spoke about how the I Am Malala campaign and how it sort of obliterates difference. So I wonder if we could think about it in another way, or maybe, in a sense, it doesn't go far enough in obliterating difference, like compared to something like Bad Fox or Max or Taliban, or something that totally obscures the revolutionary and so on. And that sort of avoids the problem of this, like, Orientalism or appropriating. Other ground we're also talking about. And also, interestingly, at the same time, it kind of solves the problem of slacktivism that we spoke about. If you go around with a valid or a bad box next time, even if you're actually being peaceful, you're probably going to get approached or beat up by the cops. So I wonder if you thought about comparing those two.
I haven't, actually. No, I'm not really knowledgeable about the references you're bringing up right now, to be honest. So you can say more about them.
Like the white mask from Mandela that like kind of associated with anonymous hackers, and also the Occupy Century. It's like a mask that covers a whole face.
I mean, I'm thinking of it in terms of the tradition of I Am campaigns, right? So we have the I Am Trayvon Martin, but you also have some of these earlier campaigns. And I mean, the annihilation of difference, you're seeing it as an intervention, right? You're seeing it as a critical intervention, which certainly is possible to see it that way. And the performance that you're talking about, that kind of performance, could work that way in a subversive way. But these I Am Malala campaigns, or the I Am Malala campaigns, like some of the others, are not working in any subversive way at all. I mean, in fact, what they're doing is they're creating comfort zones. And I would say what they're doing is they're, in a way, it's like an alibi for inaction. So yes, I guess that my answer would be yes, that, I mean, where it is now, it's not going one way or the other. I mean, it's either you can maybe annihilate difference to the point of anonymity in a subversive, performative way, you know, and that would be subversive and challenging. Or you could maybe do the more particular, which can also become more subversive and challenging. But this I Am Malala, at least the way it's been mobilized, has been just really to reaffirm a very neutral identification that's ending up being and placing us mostly in the role of consumer in the end. But yeah.
So for those of us in the room, we can continue the conversation afterwards, but we're getting a lot of questions on Twitter and Facebook, so we'll close with one. It's a comment and a question from Jamie Jones, who says, in listening to your talk, my thoughts kept coming back to recent youth activism in the United States and the tendency for such acts to be dismissed. For instance, students held a nonviolent protest in L.A. by lining desks in the street to represent those who drop out each week. Today there are youth participating in Listen's Day of Silence. What lessons do you think youth activists and mentors of youth activists can take away from Malala's activism and increase the reach of their efforts?
I think the youth activist movements that I know most about is the Dreamers, and a little bit of research on them, and then some of this girl effect and the way in which it's bringing in adolescent girls. And what I see happening, at least with some of the Girl Effect campaign, and it's a pretty massive campaign, hundreds of videos and outreach, is that it's providing templates, narrative templates, and kind of activist templates that are pragmatic in some ways, you know, and they're achieving some of the goals they seek to achieve, which are generating funds. But it reminds me, like, of the template in domestic violence movement, where I volunteered years ago in literacy work at a shelter. And, you know, the main narrative is the cycle of violence, right, that it keeps reproducing itself. And that's what caseworkers would bring out in their clients and try to get women to work through or to work against. But, you know, what I came to realize was how limiting that narrative of framing domestic violence is anyway. You know, there are other systemic things going on in our culture than just, you know, this system in your own house. So, I mean, it reminds me of that. It's like, think about the frameworks and the narratives that any group is using, utilizing, and how that actually might be taming you know, holding back your rhetoric or your claims or your goals. So to me, it's just more, you know, as a rhetorician, what I'm always thinking is just think about the frameworks, conventions, et cetera, that are shaping your discourse. And are they effective? And why might they be in some contexts and not others? I mean, the coming out narrative in The Dreamers is a good example. There's a lot of criticism about the appropriation of the lesbian and gay rights coming out narrative by The Dreamers. You know, so it's like, well, is that a good strategy? Is it not? You know, is it giving some attention maybe where there wouldn't be, or is it really causing some, you know, problems with the overlap there, or even dismissive? So I think it's, for me at least, you know, I don't see myself as a, like, providing a manual for activists. I'm more interested in what are the frameworks and narratives that activists or organizations, advocacy organizations, use to convey their message. So it'd be more kind of figure out what you're doing. Any other questions?
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.